So, Clarence.
Yes.
We are having a school board candidate forum here. I'm with Tabor 100. You're with Tabor 100, but also A. Philip Randolph.
And the Seattle Alliance of Black School Educators.
Exactly. So, and which are the districts that we're talking about today?
There are four districts that are up for election this year. It's districts 1, 2, 3, and 6.
And so what do we, and we've got all the candidates here, right?
Yes, ma'am.
So that's going to be, it should be a pretty good turnout. If we get some more people, we have a really strong event here.
We're anticipating over 40 people have registered.
Okay.
And usually more people show up than register.
So right,
we're looking for a crowd of 50 to 60.
So I think some of the issues, you know, my issue is business.
Mm-hmm.
And I really want to know how these candidates are going to encourage teachers and the schools to involve businesses and business organizations in education so that we increase and better our pool of available employees for small business that can't afford to hire the students that can make $80,000 at Nintendo and Microsoft.
Right.
So what issues does SABSE have?
Oh, I'm sure there'll be a variety of issues, disproportionality and discipline, advanced placement and, for minority students, opportunities, access, career and college readiness, supports to help them go to college, you know, filling out FAFSA and other kinds of college loan application forms. And other kinds of things. The testing will be a big issue, perhaps.
Right, and we've got a lot of issues right now. We just finished a six-day school strike, or the strike that caused schools to open late.
Right.
We've got the $100,000 a day fine.
Right. With the legislature,
The legislature.
McCleary decision.
McCleary. We've got a whole lot going on,
right.
So it should be a great event.
Yes, and we're going to be taking questions from the audience, so they're going to put them on index cards, and we'll pull from that pool to see what questions they're interested in.
Great.
All right.
Okay, so we're done.
My name is Leanna Dotson, and I will be moderating this evening's event. We would like to thank you for coming out this evening and attending this very, very important event that can help you make a decision regarding how to vote for the upcoming elections for the Seattle School Board. The purpose of this event this evening is to provide voters and residents in the Seattle area the opportunity to meet and hear from the candidates for the Seattle Public Schools Board. This evening's sponsors include the Seattle Alliance of Black School Educators, League of Education Voters, Tabor 100, the Seattle Chapter of the A. Philip Randolph Institute, Coalition of Immigrants, Refugees, Communities of Color, and Asian Pacific Islanders. Thank you to our host this evening. First, I will introduce our three panelists who will be providing questions to each of the candidates. First, starting to my left, Joyce Yee is a community organizer for the League of Education Voters. She has been actively advocating for and working with communities to increase their voice and understanding about education issues and funding. Welcome, Joyce. Aya Howe is currently the president of the Seattle Alliance of Black School Educators, an education consultant and community organizer. Ms. Howe is an education advocate and a retired teacher and former administrator in the Seattle Public Schools. The Seattle Alliance of Public School Educators partners with the Seattle Public Schools and is an advisory committee and is serving on committees including the Equity, Race, Advisory Committee, Discipline and Disproportionality, African American Think Tank, and Community Engagement, and has served on the Strategic Planning Committee. Welcome, Ms. Howe. Finally, we have Ms. Linda Kennedy joining us as our third panelist. She is the Grant Administrator for Tabor 100, Excellent Schools Now Grant. The Excellent Schools Now Grant is to encourage minority business organizations to involve themselves in education. Ms. Kennedy is an education advocate teaching media literacy and working on various projects supporting public education. Welcome, Ms. Kennedy, welcome, Ms. Howe, and welcome, Ms. Yee. Thank you to our panelists. The format for this evening's event. minute to introduce themselves to the audience. Then the three panelists, representing the three original sponsoring organizations, will ask questions. I will facilitate between each of the questions so that each candidate has an opportunity to answer the questions. The candidates will have 2 minutes each to answer the question. The timekeeper, Dr. Gary, please raise your hand. He will ensure that each candidate remains on time, so please continue to watch him because he will give you a signal at 30 seconds left, 15 seconds left, and when to stop. Then there will be 3 audience questions that will be submitted from the index cards that you received when you came in. If you still have index cards, Clarence, who is raising his hand, will collect those cards now.
We got most of them earlier.
If there's anyone in need of an index card, please raise your hand also.
Nope.
Wonderful, thank you. Now to introduce the candidates. We will first begin with District 6. I will briefly introduce each candidate, ask them to come forth and take a seat at the table in front, and they will each have 1 minute after I introduce the two of them to each provide their own introduction of themselves for 1 minute. First, Leslie Harris, a paralegal, longtime district activist, Seattle Public Schools parent, and she has been a part of the PTSA at Pathfinder and Chiefstone High School. Second, we have Marty McLaren, current incumbent on the Seattle Public School Board, former educator and former PTSA president at Washington Middle School. Welcome to you both. Ms. Harris, your 1 minute will begin now for your introduction.
Thank you for this opportunity. It is a wild ride. I'm having a blast. I am learning on a straight up curve, and I already have a pretty good foundation. It's too important to look the other way for our kids, our communities, and our taxpayers. We can do better. If you like the status quo, I am not your girl. You do not want to vote for me if you think the status quo is acceptable. I have spent a good bit of my life, my working life, as a paralegal for victims and workers, and I've taken on with my small team the biggest, baddest, meanest corporations in this country and in the world, so I'm not scared of anybody. I've had my hat handed to me working on national, state, and local boards, so I get fiduciary duty, I get the concept of policy making, and I thank you ever so much.
So good evening, and thank you all for being here. I'm Marty McLaren. I used to be a math teacher in the district, and I've been on the board for 4 years now. And I come with a 20-year history of working to bring people together, to strengthen education, and to undo institutional racism in education and other systemic oppressions in education. I feel strongly that we can do this together, and that partnerships between people in the district and people in the community, parents, are absolutely essential to continuing to move forward. We've made tremendous progress in the last 4 years, especially in the last year with a new, very, very knowledgeable and skilled and strong superintendent. And I'm hoping that I'm looking for continuity in leadership in the district. Thank you.
Thank you to both candidates for their introduction. Now we will turn it over to the three panelists for their questions.
Okay, so my question is for both of you. What is your position on Common Core state standards and student assessments?
Yeah, we get that turned off.
I think we have overdone assessments by a wide margin. I think that it has taken up way too much instructional time. I think that the fact that this school board waited 5 months to come up with a resolution about assessments is very, very distressing. I think the fact that assessments ended up being part of a collective bargaining agreement is very distressing. Collective bargaining agreements are necessarily done in dark rooms. If we had had a proactive, responsive board, it would not have been part of a collective bargaining agreement. Same with a number of other non-financial deals that came through that CBA. And that CBA process, and parents and community members on the streets with the teachers, I think is a real snapshot of what we have not done well in this city. Common Core is an assessment, it's not a curriculum. It wasn't vetted real well, and we should ask who purchased it. We should ask, where did it come from? Where is the pedagogy? And last, is every child college bound, and what are we going to do with our trades? We have an entire generation retiring, and we don't have enough technical education in this city to fill those holes. And those are good family wage jobs that support families and that support this city. So we need to take a look at these things. But the fact that there was a vacuum that the Seattle Education Association took advantage of, which any organization should if there is a vacuum, says volumes about the lack of proactive leadership on the Seattle Public School Board. I intend to be a very proactive leader. Thank you.
So, Common Core's state standards are very different from the Smarter Balance assessments. The Common Core standards are learning standards, mastery standards. And while I have some quibbles with them, especially the math standards in general, I don't think they're a bad thing. I think it's good for us to have some common understanding of what goals we want our students to master in terms of learning and knowledge. I do have a lot of quibbles with it, but it's a good start. As far as the Smarter Balance assessments go, lots and lots of problems with that. The basic idea of standardized testing has just morphed into this monster that has consumed so much time and energy in the district, and it's incredibly unfortunate. And I actually am very pleased with the fact that this was an important piece of our collective bargaining. I'm really pleased that this was a bargaining team of 40 people, 40 teachers, who were bargaining with the district team of about 13 people. So it was good representation. And they brought that issue forward as something that needed to be worked on by all of us collaboratively. And I just lost my train of thought. There will be a future committee and a process between the union and the district to develop a shared understanding of what do our teachers and what do our parents and what do our leaders think it is the ideal way to balance testing and the learning that needs to go forth in class time. We have something, we call it formative testing versus summative testing. And the summative testing is when it's all over. Formative happens in the classroom.
Thank you. And just as a note for all the candidates, the pink pieces of paper with the timekeeper are a stop, and the yellow, so the yellow is 30 seconds. Now to our next question.
Good afternoon. We recognize that states, cities, counties, and school systems are different points on the continuum in terms of their ability to talk about the impact of race in education. From your perspective, what is the impact of race on whites and children of color in our Seattle public schools?
It's huge. It's huge. It's the underlying tension that starts the whole imbalance of our society, as far as I'm concerned. In Seattle, about 6 years ago, we went to a new student assignment plan that was aimed to bring students back to their neighborhood schools. There's a lot to be said about that. I don't know how each person out here feels about it. I really value community. But the truth is that with the new student assignment, the neighborhood assignment plan, and with gentrification in Seattle, our schools are they're resegregating. I live in a West Seattle neighborhood where Highland Park, or West Seattle Elementary, and Fairmount Park are a mile apart, and there are 80% children of poverty, and I think it's 80% children of color. I'm a little off on my stats there, at West Seattle Elementary. Fairmount Park is the exact opposite. That is a travesty, as far as I'm concerned, and yet it's something that you mentioned, county, city, state, it's something that we as a whole community need to be able to grapple with and talk about. I, as a privileged white person, need to listen to people on the other side who have lived with racism all their lives and be open to working together in community to think creatively about how we as a community are going to address these issues. I think everybody knows about all the negative impacts of racism on our society. Racism, unaware maybe, is alive and well in Seattle as it is all over the country, and teachers need to have education and training in practices that are culturally aware, that allow them to shift their practices and provide a positive environment for our students.
I don't know how to address this issue in 2 minutes. It is so immense, it is so complex, but I think that the track record of the Seattle Public Schools and this particular board, that apparently continuity is the platform, is appalling. Dr. Carol Simmons, whom I believe a great many of you know, a former principal at SPS, got up last night and she said, "Well, I'm glad we're starting to talk about disproportionate discipline of elementary school children. We've been talking about it for 30 years. Yep. Unacceptable that we finally passed it last night. Unacceptable. Unacceptable that we close Middle College at High Point with no notice. That we close a school that saves lives. Now, Middle College at High Point ended up there because of administrative foobars at South Seattle. The then general counsel chose not to address paying minimal rent after over a decade of no rent. So then, with Marty McLaren's help, we got them moved to neighborhood house at High Point. High minority representation in that program. Close. No good reasons, no good explanations, and that same general counsel who was administratively discharged, who retired, is now on the payroll until January 1, 2016. That doesn't work for me. That does not work for me. Economic and racial redlining happening around our schools does not work for me. My child is a privileged white girl with two professional white parents. Some of our fosters have not been, and the kids in the neighborhood are most definitely not. Thank you.
Thank you. And now to another question.
How will you address the concerns small business owners have that students graduate from Seattle public schools completely unprepared for the world of work? And how will you encourage business to involve itself, to promote business involvement in advocating and supporting quality public education for all students?
I love this question so much because we can do, again, so much better. I take in interns all year, every year, and I've got college graduates that can't do a three-line business letter. That's unacceptable. We need to open our doors wide. We need to have internships. We need to have business and labor education in our high schools. We need to recognize that we are the fastest growing city, and we've got thousands of H-1B visas out there, but we're importing folks from other countries. That's crazy. We gotta grow our own. Mm-hmm. MG South International High School has a business academy, a finance academy, and they do great work. And it's run by a gentleman that came to teaching later in life after a very successful career. We need to make those options available. We need to partner with our community members. We need to invite them inside the schools instead of putting up our hands and, oh, we don't want you. Or we're just going to make it really darn difficult for you to help. We need to say, oh, set up a table in our lunchroom and tell people how to be engineers and what it took. We need to have apprenticeship programs in our school building in BACS and BTA. We don't do a good job at all on apprenticeship. Ask the labor folks. They testified last night at the school board meeting as well. We need to hold hands and make our circle bigger and more welcoming because we can't afford to do it all, and we certainly aren't doing it all that well. Thank you.
So I agree totally with Ms. Harris on everything she said. These are excellent ideas, all things that we need to be doing, and I heartily support them. We're doing a lot, and I could, on the top of my head, the IB programs come to mind, but in fact, we know that the IB programs are also severely challenged because of funding issues. Career and technical education, we're doing really innovative things on that. And again, funding issues, and also a big sort of elephant in the room about career and technical education, in my mind, is transportation. We have some wonderful programs throughout the district, but a student at Hale High School who wants to go to one of the academies at South, it has a tremendous transportation challenge. So, there are big problems, and again, the idea of partnership, which we seem to agree on, are really critical. I have suggested to, who have I suggested this to? I guess to Dr. Nyland and to some people on City Council that we need to have a joint task force consisting of people from the school district, the city, the county, talking about our transportation issues that are a shared responsibility of all of us if we want our students to have access to all the different offerings. Small businesses and their connection with school is absolutely imperative. And it's really exciting to me when small business owners volunteer to do mentorships. There are all kinds of connections that are previously existing between people in the community. So, for example, at Madison Middle School Career Day,
people of all kinds of business and professional backgrounds come in and share with students what they're doing and what their lifestyle is like. So it's happening. It's not happening as much as we want. The status quo is not adequate, but we've seen great progress, and I look forward to seeing more.
And to our fourth question of the evening. Well, we recognize the importance of your role in running for school board candidate. We also believe your running for a school board position means that you care about the education of all children. So please share one way that you personally plan to address the disparities and inequities experienced by children of color, especially African American children and people of color, to help ensure that all children achieve academic success and graduate from high school.
So it's been my privilege to be involved in the conversations that have led up to the development of the superintendent's gap closing initiative for African American males. And I have this copy that this is one of the old drafts of it. The name of it has changed, but it's a blueprint, it's an action plan for addressing the root causes and setting clear goals for closing the opportunity gap and closing and ending disproportionality in discipline for our students. If you go to the district website and type in, Closing Opportunity Gaps, you can see the latest draft of this. This is a work in progress, but it's got many, many parts. It has a data part that in black and white, color actually shows you the dreadful data. And then it has goals and measures for African American male achievement. And the research shows that by lifting these students, we will lift all the students in the district. This year, our focus, there are five goals and measures. This year, we're focusing on mastery of the core subjects and elimination of disproportionalities. In other years, we'll be focusing on early year success, resilience, agency, and voice, and college graduation and career ready. But you can't do everything at once, and part of the prime beauty of this board and this administration is a clear priority to discipline our leadership, including the board, to choose priorities and stick to them at least for a year. So all of us candidates, there will be at least three new ones who are on the board, will be called on to discipline themselves, to stick to the priorities that have been made, and to modify them in subsequent years so that we can actually make forward progress. So I could spend 30 minutes easy describing this whole thing to you. Oh, that's right, I get confused. The yellow and the pink, thank you.